Our next Dirac medalist was recognized for the discovery of supergravity theory in 1976 and major contributions in subsequent developments of the theory. Let's welcome Dirac medalist of 1993, Sergio Ferrara.
Well, I shared this prize with Professor Peter Banio-Benoitzen from Stony Brook and Daniel Friedman from MIT. At that time, he was also in Stony Brook. But I'm going to talk not about the foundation of supergravity, but some application of supergravity, which became topical in the last 10 or 15 years, related to the study of some properties of black holes, and which may be also relevant for this issue of finiteness or supergravity and whether supergravity is a different theory of string theory. I'm going to talk about very general aspects of black holes in supergravity, and in doing that I will use some mathematical tools which will not be probably clear to the whole audience, but my talk, I apologize, is a bit technical. In fact, the subject I'm going to talk is something which was named, is motivated by other branches of physics, namely by branches which study dynamical systems, and is called the attractor mechanism. And this mechanism states that scalar field trajectories, which are present in supergravity backgrounds, behave as dynamical systems. Namely, in the flow of the black hole from asymptotic infinity to the horizon of the black hole, and I will talk only about extremal zero temperature black holes. So these are black holes, zero temperature is needed in order to have supersymmetric black holes. You can have also extremal non-supersymmetric black holes, but this is what is confined my talk. Then the scalar field in the radial evolution from infinity to the horizon have the property that independently of the value of as infinity, which is any point of the moduli space of the theory, they approach the same value at the horizon. And this value is determined by a criticality condition, which essentially is the condition which ensures that the scalar field has a zero velocity in approaching to the horizon. And this is a condition which is needed in order to have a regular black hole in this kind of configurations. So to make this thing in a pictorial way, these are the scalar field trajectories. You see that you can start from any point. This is a pointer. You can start any point at infinity, and respectively the point you start, you approach the same value at the horizon. And this value is given by the fact that the velocity of the scalar field is actually, through the equation of motion, proportional to the gradient of some potential function. And this gradient going to zero at the horizon essentially says that the scalar field, the critical value of the scalar field at the horizon is the one which extremizes the potential. This potential, not surprisingly, is going to be related to the central charge of the supersymmetry algebra for reasons which are related to the BPS bound of supersymmetry. Just to make a sketchy description, let me tell you that generically an extremal black hole background has a metric which is completely determined by this warp factor, capital U. And this warp factor, together with the scalar field, can be used as dynamical variable of some one-dimensional, almost geodetic action, which is given here, which is essentially contain a free part and then a potential term, which is precisely this function which enter in the attractor mechanism problem. It's important that this potential can be rewritten in many cases in terms of a kind of prepotential or superpotential W, which in fact it appeared in the supergravity literature much before black holes, essentially introduced by Daniel Friedman, Townsend, and others, and it was called fake superpotential. It's essentially a potential which coincides with the central charge for BPS configuration, but it's something else in the case of non-BPS black hole. The important point is that through this fake superpotential, the equation of motion, which determine the flow of the scalar field and of this warp factor in a black hole background, become first order, in spite of the fact that that the original Einstein equation are second order. For supersymmetric configuration, this is a known fact. When W is the central charge, the supersymmetric equation of motion are really usually first order equation. What is more surprisingly is that this happens also for non-BPS configuration if one uses W superpotential. And this is precisely the case of N equal 8 supergravity. In N equal 8 supergravity, different groups have shown that there is this W which makes the first order equation of motion for black hole background. So in some sense, N equal 8 supergravity, also at the level of description of black holes, has some hidden symmetries which allow the simpler description of the black hole background. So let me tell you what happens in this BPS, non-BPS black hole. This BPS and non-BPS black hole have this W, which in a certain situation, depending on the charges, which will be controlled by this I4 invariant, which I'm going to define in a moment. If this invariant is different from zero, the black hole is BPS if it is positive, and in non-BPS if it is negative. But the thing they have in common is that this W function is actually bounded from below in the moduli space in both cases. And it has an extremum which fixes this extremum corresponded to the value of the critical value at the horizon of the scalar field. And this extremum is interesting because the value of this W function at the extremum is actually the entropy, the classical Bekenstein-Hawking entropy of the black hole. Instead, if you go to infinity, the value of W for scalar field at infinity is nothing but the IDM mass of the black hole. So this W function is the IDM mass at asymptotic infinity and become related to the entropy when it is computed at the horizon. And this horizon has a universal property, which is actually a particular case of the Maldacena conjecture. This black hole have all a universal geometry, which is a product of a two-dimensional anti-de-Sitter time two-sphere, which is the analogous of IDS5 cross S5 or the D3 brain in the case of 10-dimensional supergravity. It is interesting, however, that in four dimensions exists a configuration of the charges for which this invariant, which determines the area of the black hole, is actually zero. In this situation, the Einsteinian approximation of the black hole fails because the geometry of the black hole becomes singular. There is a singular geometry. And this charge configuration, actually in N equal 8, corresponds precisely to an enhanced supersymmetric black hole. They correspond to black hole which, instead of preserving four supersymmetric charges, which is what is called 1/8 BPS black hole, they correspond to 1/4, 1/2 BPS black hole. Now, this black hole, which can reach zero mass in the moduli space, where you see the mass is no longer unbounded from below, are identified precisely with these states that Michael Green was talking about earlier. So one can say, in fact, that the fact that there are these singular solutions, if these singular solutions are kept in four dimensions, this is a sign that the theory doesn't live in four dimensions, but lives in some higher dimension. Because in a spectrum, there are infinitely many states which have arbitrary small mass. So the four-dimensional effective theory is no longer adequate to describe this object. So this quartic invariant I was considering is actually interesting because it's related to some fancy mathematics. This quartic invariant in n equal 8 is related to some invariant of the 56-dimensional representation of E7, and which was, in fact, found by Cartan. And a quartic invariant, if you write the central charge of the supersymmetry algebra in diagonal form, is a bunch of terms which are quartic in eigenvalue of the central charge matrix. And this eigenvalue of the central charge matrix determine whether the black hole is BPS or non-BPS. And I was saying that there is a complete classification which I made with Murat Gunaydin almost more than 10 years ago, where you can classify charge orbits of this 56-dimensional representation, much as the same you can classify orbits of any representation of a classical group. And these charge orbits, they split in three different categories, depending whether the black hole is 1/8 BPS, non-BPS, and 1/4 BPS. The two set of orbits which are here are the ones which have the IDS2 cross S2 geometry. So the IDS2 cross S2 geometry, in some sense, which is the analogous of the IDS conformal field theory conjecture for zero brains. These are zero brains, and this IDS2 cross S2 is a conformal geometry at the horizon. It's precisely the four-dimensional analog of Maldacena description of D-brains.